Morning and welcome. We are indeed in summer. We know we're in summer because it's warm and also because we just started at 10 o'clock. And so we'll welcome the people who come at 11. They'll get the altar call at the end of the sermon and they'll all come forward and we'll get to see who they are. So here we go. We're going to sing about the greatness of God thematically in terms of what we're doing this morning. And you can start up by standing and singing. We're going to do Great is the Lord. It's number 12, and then your hymn book number 37, of course, is all projected. Great is the Lord, he is holy and just, by his power we trust in his love. Great is the Lord, he is faithful and true, by his mercy he proves he is love.
Richard, the glory and majesty of your name rings back memories, singing that in a choir long, long ago. What a beautiful, I think it's Tom Fetke number, isn't it? Beautiful, beautiful piece. Always seems to evoke that memory of worship. I am very glad to see more than just a few people here this morning. As Richard said, this is the first Sunday starting at 10 o'clock. And I am especially thankful that you are all here today. If you are visiting with us, find that welcome card in the pew pocket in front of you. Fill it out and put it in the offering plate when it comes by in a few minutes. We are welcoming Tim Goodwin with us this morning to bring us a message from God's Word. Tim looks after community relations at Hope Mission Calgary, and we are so glad to have him here. I met Tim for the first time when he came to pick up the food from our food drive back in, when was it? It was early May, I think, that we saw each other after our April food collection. And so I had the pleasure of meeting him at that time. Next week, we have someone who is very well known to this congregation, Dr. Gordon Grieve, coming to fill the pulpit. And in the last two Sundays of July, we have Schaefer Parker returning. So we'll look forward to hearing them as well. Today, after the morning service, and I mean right after the benediction, I would like, if you are a voting member here at Trinity, I would like you to remain right where you are to consider a motion. It may not take long. I don't know. I'm not a prognosticator to know how long it will take. But there is a motion that we provide financial support for Anthony and Rachel as they go on a mission trip to Moldova with Teach Beyond later this month. So, please stay. We need at least a quorum of 10 voting members. So please, at least 10 people stay. If not, I'll be down in the foyer bringing people back up. We have and are continuing to encourage our youth to be part of the Summer Youth Celebration, SYC, being held in Three Hills, Alberta at Prairie Bible College. You still have a little bit of time left to sign up online if you'd like to go. Trinity's providing transportation and refunding part of that registration fee for families. I also remind you that Trinity has its VBS coming up at the end, the last weekend in August, on the Friday night, Saturday morning, and Sunday morning. It's going to be a different kind of Sunday morning here, as we will incorporate VBS already in progress with what we do for our Sunday morning worship service. That afternoon on the Sunday, right after church, we'll have a barbecue in the back parking lot with a lot of games and inviting our VBS families to attend as well. The three-day theme is on Bible history. So bring your friends, bring your children, and your children's friends, and their family as well. Let's pray, and I'll ask the men who are collecting the morning offering to come forward, and let's make sure that we dedicate the rest of this service to our wonderful Lord and Savior's glory, the same as it began. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this day. I thank you that we can sit in relative comfort during a hot day. Lord, this is the season when our city goes a little out of the ordinary to be country and cowfolk, but that's fun. That's fun. But Lord, there's so much that isn't fun that goes on in Stampede Week. I pray for our people. I pray for our city that we would not engage in things that do not please you, but that we would rejoice in sport. We would rejoice in husbandry. We would rejoice in neighborly fellowship. Father, as we meet here today, gathering to worship you, we do so with our tithes, our offerings. We do so sharing our lives with others around us, our joys, our sorrows. Father, we also share around your word. And I pray that you would move mightily through Tim as your word is proclaimed and expounded. I ask that you would continue to remind us of who you are throughout whatever is said or sung or done in this service. These things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
you to stand and sing.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. His good is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. With a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, His love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us, forever. To the setting sun, His love endures forever. By the grace of God, we'll carry on. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong. Forever God is with us, forever, forever. The love of God is greater far than tongue or pen can ever tell. Beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell. The guilty pair bow down with care. God gave His Son to win. His erring child He reconciled and pardoned from his sin. Oh, love of God, how rich and pure, shall forevermore endure the saints and angels. When years of time have passed away and earthly thrones and kingdoms fall, when men who hear refuse to pray on rocks and hills and mountains call, God's love so sure shall still endure, all measureless and strong, redeeming grace to Adam's race, the saints and angels' song. O love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong, it shall forevermore endure, the saints and angels' song. Could we think the ocean fill, and were the skies of parchment made, were every stalk on earth a quill, and every man a scribe by trade, to write the love of God above would drain the oceans dry, nor could the scroll contain the whole, though stretched from sky to sky. O love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong, it shall forevermore endure, the saints and angels' song.
You may be seated.
Let's bow together in a time of prayer, shall we? Heavenly Father, we come before You, a congregation made up of believers and visitors alike. We're thankful for who you are. We praise your name for what you have done and who you are to those of us who put our faith and trust in your Son. As a congregation, Lord, we come before you with specific prayer. Prayer request for our transition team, Lord, as they seek to finalize the pastoral search process tonight. Lord, we also pray for the one you are preparing as Trinity's pastor. We also ask that you would prepare our hearts in turn. Lord, we're thankful for Anthony and Rachel and their decision to go with Teach Beyond to Moldova in ministry. And I pray that you would give them safety in their travels and that you would bless their time of ministry among the people of Moldova. May your gospel be proclaimed mightily and that you move in the hearts of those who attend and those who are otherwise affected. Father, I pray for those of our church who are going to give leadership and then as well to our youth who are attending SYC later this month. I know it can be a very life-impacting experience, and I pray that for our people. I pray that you would transform our youth by the renewing of their minds, to be conformed to your good, acceptable, and perfect will. Keep them safe during travel and during their activities throughout the week. Father, I pray for the children and families who will be attending VBS next month. I pray for the workers who are preparing for VBS. And I ask that you will orchestrate and facilitate the delivery of your truth through us and draw many to yourself. Heavenly Father, I pray for our congregation, those with medical concerns and some recovering from loss. I pray for those with employment concerns and those looking for new directions in their life. I pray specifically for Teresa, for Jovan and Grace, for Jeannie May, for Gracia Blessy, for Isha Venice, for Ed and Brenda. Lord, that they may grow in their knowledge and love of you, in the process of being conformed to the image of your Son, that you keep their paths straight and safe this summer. Lord, I've already prayed that you would move mightily through Tim, and as he comes now and shares from your word, I pray that we would have open hearts, open minds, listening to what we can learn from you this morning. These things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Starting at Hope Mission. There we go. I've watched incredible circumstances come about in caring for God's children. When you bring volunteers and donors together, incredible things happen. Sometimes it works out. Sometimes it doesn't. For example, just over a year ago, just before Stampede last year, we had a phone call. I received a phone call from the Calgary Stampede, and they had food that they were looking to give to an organization. And our cupboards were, well, the cooler was a little bit low. We were coming up on food hampers. We were low on produce, and that night I had just prayed, Lord, it's to care for your children. You know, I can't create the produce. I can't create the dairy. I can't do that. But you can provide. And we got this phone call. And they had a lot of food to donate. They had 10 pallets of food. Now, if you come for a tour one day, you'll see our cooler. If our cooler was completely empty, I could put 10 pallets in there. But our cooler isn't typically empty. We've got shelves and we've got a few things in there and this. Two or three pallets would be perfect. And we explained that to them, that we could take two or three pallets. Now, the trick was we really needed one of two things. We either needed a trailer or we needed a big truck. We had two Dodge minivans. So we weren't sure how we could do it, but we said, you know what, we'll figure out a way and we'll take two or three pallets. The trick was they had 10. And they wanted all 10 to go at once. So that was a little bit of a deal breaker. When something like that happens, it can be so tempting to wonder why God didn't provide what was needed. Why wasn't he faithful to his children in this situation? Is it easy to turn that monitor on as well? You're on top of it. I'm just not. So this morning, we're going to be taking a look at Psalm 111 and looking at the faithfulness of God and the impact that it should have on us. God's idea of faithfulness is different from the faithfulness that we offer and we've come to expect. Has anyone here ever had a close relationship that wound up ending with heartache? Has anyone here maybe had a best friend who moved away? Has anyone had somebody lie to you? Causes hurt, causes a lot of hurt. When friends move away, when relationships come to an end, there's a lot of pain. You know, sometimes things don't work out right. When something like that happens, when something we're counting on fails to come through for us, that hurts. This morning I'm going to talk about the term forever, and then I'm going to look at three different things regarding God's covenant. We're going to look at the fact that God ordains his covenant, God remembers his covenant, and he looks for us to respond to his covenant. When things don't go as planned, how are we affected? How are our relationships affected? The friend that moved away left a hole in your heart. When a couple is struggling with some issue, it leaves one of them feeling, you know, maybe do they need to hold back a little bit? You know, can they trust their spouse's devotion in the future? When a broken promise, I'm sure people have heard promises come out, I will definitely be at that leadership meeting at 10 o'clock. Or, yes, Mom, I'll definitely clean my room this morning. Or the teenager, I'll be home by 8. Well, then when it doesn't happen, where does that leave us? Are we going to extend that same level of trust next time? I'm going to go back and give you a little bit of my background. I spent 32 years in sales and management, and I did pretty well most of those years. I was in doing well in sales. I was in leadership at the church, helping teach Sunday school. I was helping with the youth, married a lovely lady, and we have four amazing kids. And a few years ago, oil and gas dropped off. Sales weren't going so well. Then COVID hit and things slowed down even more. It started to feel like, you know, maybe things weren't going so well. Maybe, you know, for whatever reason, God was kind of leaving me to be. In the midst of COVID, our company had to do some downsizing. And in the Canadian division, I was one of the ones that was let go, so I was packaged out. I've never experienced anything like that before. That was devastating. It was terrifying. How was I going to provide for a family? How was God going to take what I was no longer doing and be able to make that work for us? What was his plan? I knew he had to have one, but what was it? What did he want from me? You know what he wanted from me? He wanted the same thing that he wants from each of you. He wants all of us. No reservations, no holding back. Heart, soul, mind, and strength. And that's a lot when things aren't going right. How do we know we're safe in his hands? Now, that might sound like an easy question. And in the end, it is, but it's not easy to stick to. With all the hurt, with all the difficulties that we go through, how can we know God isn't going to let us down? I believe Psalm 111 was written by somebody who's experienced very similar thoughts at points. We don't know for a fact who wrote Psalm 111, so we refer to them as the psalmist. The Psalms are a collection of five different books of songs and prayers, and Psalm 111 is part of the fifth book. And it's believed that this book was written just after the Babylonian exile. Okay, so let's set the stage a little. The people of Israel had endured 430 years of slavery in Egypt, where it seemed, I'm sure, like God had forgotten about them. Moses led them out of Egypt, and they spent another 40 years in the desert because of idolatry, and they wandered. Then hundreds of years later, Jerusalem's destroyed, and the people of Judah are exiled for almost 40 years in Babylon. So following all of this, shortly after their release, the psalmist writes Psalm 111. Now I'm going to read it here. Feel free to close your eyes and just listen. I will extol the Lord with all my heart in the council of the upright and in the assembly. Great are the works of the Lord. They're pondered by all who delight in them. Glorious and majestic are his deeds, and his righteousness endures forever. Remember that word. We're going to hit that a couple more times. He has caused his wonders to be remembered. The Lord is gracious and compassionate. He provides food for those who fear him. He remembers his covenant forever. He's shown his people the power of his works, giving them the lands of other nations. The works of his hands are faithful and just, and his precepts are trustworthy. They are established forever and ever, enacted in faithfulness and uprightness. He provided redemption for his people. He ordained his covenant forever. Holy and awesome is his name. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All who follow his precepts have good understanding. To him belongs eternal praise. It's Some other translations finish off that last verse with, "He deserves praise forever." So the word forever, did you notice how many times it comes out in the psalm? It shows up 5 times. Now, can we even comprehend the word forever? Since the flood, mankind's years are numbered to, what, 100 years. So forever is limited to, well, that's just it isn't limited. There is no end to the number of 100-year lifetimes you can put into forever. We were watching one of our favorite shows Friday evening. Do I have any Doctor Who fans here? Okay. Nope. Okay. A little bit. Okay. So Doctor Who is a time traveler. Okay. And he solves problems throughout history, past and history yet to come. And in this one particular episode, which is ironically called Heaven Sent, don't ask, he ends up in a time loop and he's trying to break through a wall, a big, massive, thick crystal wall. And all he can do is punch at it. But because of the time loop, he gets to come back however many times necessary and punch it a few more times. And he shares a story about a little bird. And I love this one. If you can imagine a diamond mountain, we've got the Rocky Mountains not far from here. Imagine one of those made out of diamond, the hardest substance that we have. And a little bird that once a year comes and it sharpens its bill on the mountain and then off it goes. And then a year later it comes back and it sharpens its bill and off it goes. Now when that diamond mountain is ground to dust, that's still just the very beginning of forever. Forever is so far beyond our comprehension. In the original language, the psalmist uses 2 different words for forever. I'd like to quickly take a look at the difference. So verses 5 and 9, in the original language, it's the word ad. Means a lasting time, forever. The word emphasizes the length of forever, but it's understood to have kind of a point of reference. So you can have from forever to now. You can have from now until forever. So when we think about God issuing his covenant, and his covenant will stand forever. Verse 5, he has provided food for those who fear him. He remembers his covenant forever. And in verse 9, he has sent redemption to his people. He has ordained his covenant forever. Just how long a track record do we need to be comfortable with something? Jesus represents the new covenant. Now, Jesus walked in bodily form 2,000 years ago, just over. If that isn't enough history for you, let's go back to Moses. Moses received God's covenant approximately 3,500 years ago. Okay, so we've had 3,500 years of God ordained his covenant forever. We're 3,500 years in. There's another version of forever used in verses 3, 8, and 10, though. The original word is olam, and it means distant past and distant future. As long as something lasts, all of eternity. Think in terms of from forever and until forever. Okay, so we're just a little point in the middle of it. There has never been a time, and there will never be a time, when it doesn't apply. Let's look at how the psalmist uses olam in his writing. Verse 3, all that he does is splendid and majestic. His righteousness endures forever. We're just a point in the middle of that. In verse 8, referring to God's precepts or his rules, they are established forever and ever. and acted in truth and uprightness. And then in verse 10, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All who follow his instructions have good insight. His praise endures forever. God's existence in terms of time is way beyond what we can even wrap our heads around. It's something to contemplate when you read John's words, eternal life. John, the apostle who spoke about the glorious divinity of Jesus, and he used that phrase 17 times. John was present with Jesus. He walked with Jesus. He saw Jesus crucified, and he saw the risen Jesus. If anyone understood the weight of the words eternal life, it was John. He was there and he saw it. God is timeless. Let's take a look at verse 9. He has sent redemption to his people. He has ordained his covenant forever. His name is holy and awe-inspiring. We often think of ordained as referring to ministry, an ordained minister, or being admitted into ministry. If we go back to the time of writing, ordain can also mean to give an order or put a rule in place. So you begin something. We have God putting his covenant in place at that time. Now, for some of us, the word covenant might not be so unusual. For others, it might be new, or it can seem very, very particular. But a covenant, simply put, is an agreement. Okay? A contract between two or more parties. And it doesn't necessarily have to go both ways. A promise is a covenant. A marriage is a covenant. God's promise to Abraham back in Genesis 15, on that day the Lord made a covenant with Abraham saying, I give this land to your offspring from the brook of Egypt to the great river, the Euphrates River. Abraham was not required to do anything. God made that covenant. That was a promise. The psalmist uses the word forever, yet sometimes we hear of the new covenant in Jesus, right? So what about the old covenant that was supposed to apply forever? God ordained his covenant forever. Well, if we remember from the book of Matthew, where Matthew records Jesus' words, don't think that I came to abolish the law or the prophets. I did not come to abolish, but to fulfill. Jesus didn't come to nullify the Mosaic covenant. He stands to meet the requirements for all those who make him Lord over their lives, because we can't fulfill that covenant. We can't meet the requirement. Jesus was able to. God's covenant is still ordained. He said it was ordained forever, and it is. It still applies. The difference is that our cost on our side of it, that has been paid by Christ. The verse tells us that God, in his infinite authority, made a covenant with his people and that he ordained it from when it was made until forever. There's a big difference between ordained and remembered. Think about promises made in the moment. I was talking about some of those. You know, I'll clean my room. I promise. I will be there on time for that meeting. I promise. Have everything ready to go. How about when your husband promises to look after a particular task? No, really, there's no need to remind him every 6 months. He has promised. We read throughout the scriptures about God remembering. In Genesis 8, God remembered Noah. Genesis 19, God remembered Abraham. In Genesis 30, God remembered Rachel. In 1 Samuel, the Lord remembered Hannah. But it goes beyond people and specific promises. Psalm 93, God has remembered his love and faithfulness. And in Psalm 105, he has remembered his holy promise. And again in Psalm 136, he remembered us in our humiliation. Has anyone ever told you God forgets your sins? Okay, try to imagine this conversation. God, I'm really sorry for what I did yesterday. What was that? I don't remember. My sin from yesterday. I prayed about it just last night. Ah. Nope, still nothing. What did you do? Cheat, steal, murder, commit adultery? God, when I intentionally lied about what I did just to keep out of trouble at work. Oh, right. That would be bad. Sorry, I can't seem to remember. Believe me, God doesn't forget. He remembers. He's the creator of the universe. There is nothing he doesn't know and remember. What he chooses to do, though, is to leave it in the past because it's been dealt with and forgiven, and he's not going to bring it up again. God loves you too much to keep bringing up our sins, the forgiven sins. He loves you too much to keep bringing them up. That would make you feel guilty. That's not what he's doing. It's forgiven. That's what the new covenant's all about. Your part in that new covenant is to repent of those sins and follow Jesus. God doesn't forget. He remembers your name. He remembers what makes you smile. He remembers how many hairs you have on your head, even the short ones. He remembers everything about you. Nowhere in the scripture does it say, God forgot. Not the way we use the word, because he doesn't. There have been times when we've been hurt, though, deeply hurt, when we have felt forgotten by God. So why should we risk being that vulnerable again, even if it's God? In verse 10, it says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All who follow his instructions have good insight. His praise endures forever. Many people, Christians included, feel uncomfortable with the word fear. Okay, in this context, the word fear can kind of seem intimidating. It's okay to fear a snake. It's okay to fear walking through a field of thistle if you're wearing shorts. We're Canadians, so it's okay to fear that grizzly and stay in the safety of our cars while all the tourists get out and take pictures and try to feed it. Every time the phrase fear of the Lord appears in the Bible, the actual word that is translated as fear, yirah, conveys the meaning along the lines of reverence. Okay? So you see, he wants me to follow the example that Jesus was. Out of reverence for the Lord. You know, a knight will serve under a tyrant king as long as they obey and as long as the king is there. But as soon as the king isn't, they're off the hook. They serve out of that kind of fear. A knight serving under a noble king, a king that he reveres and trusts, that knight will serve whether the king is present or not. And sometimes their commitment and their dedication go beyond the end of the king's life. That's the kind of reverence that the psalmist writes about. When things went sideways for me at work, a couple of things happened. First, my pastor, his name's Tyler, he asked me out to lunch. He said, I've got a couple questions for you. Quite often that would mean, I'm thinking about preaching a series on the book of Matthew. What do you think? So we get out, And he says, so, have you thought about going back to school? I said, what? Tyler, I'm 54. No, I haven't thought about going back to school. I've been out for 30 years now. He said, well, I think ministry might be something to consider. I said, well, you know, I'm not going to say you're wrong, but I would have to feel called. I would not take something like that lightly. He said, fair enough. So there's a complication with that, Tyler, is I don't know what that would look like. So he said, well, for him, it was when three or four people came to him and said, Tyler, I think you should consider ministry. He said, and they hadn't talked to one another or anything. I thought, maybe God's saying something here. Maybe I should do this. So has that ever happened to you? And I kind of sat there going, yes. He said, 15 or 20 people over a span of about 10 years. He goes, oh, so are you listening? So I talked to my family, who were amazing. I said, you know, it would mean going back to school for a couple of years, not working. Things are going to get pretty tight. What are your thoughts? And they're all like, well, yeah, I think so. I think this is a long time coming. So I went back to seminary. And after I finished my program, I came out, and I didn't know where God wanted to put me. So I let the denomination know I was available, and I sent my resume out to a bunch of Christian organizations, and I got a call from Hope Mission. And I knew Kelly Rowe, my predecessor. Kelly was very focused. He was amazing at what he did. He was out at a lot of churches and everything. And I thought, wow, you know, if there was a role with Hope Mission that was sales, that would be it for sure. And my family had always paid the price when I was in sales, and I had tunnel vision. I thought, that's not what God has called me into. So I went and I met with them. I'd actually applied for kitchen assistant. Me, burning pancakes and all the rest, yeah. And I went for the interview, and they said, we'd like to talk to you about a different role, though. And I thought, oh, no, it's going to be community relations. They said, hey, we'd like to talk to you about the community relations role. I went, see, God, see? And at the end of the interview, here's me sitting there going, I feel called, you know, into some sort of a pastoral role or some sort of ministry, not community relations, not sales, please, not sales. And the head of preventative programs, finishing up the interview, he says, Tim, you can kind of think of this as being pastor to the community. And I sat there and I went, I get it. I have loved the role since day one. Day two is the day I got my butt kicked by a 9-year-old at basketball. I get to go out and tell the stories. I get to see things unfolding that are way beyond having people organize them. Things come together that are way too big for people to orchestrate. My family was in total support of me returning to school 54 years ago. At age 54, not 54 years ago. I'm not that old. At age 54, they were totally in support. I got to graduate the same year as our second son. It was kind of neat. So after finishing seminary, and I'm starting at Hope Mission, I was a couple weeks in, maybe three or four, and I took a wander through the building, and I'd go on little prayer walks. I went through the pantry where we draw from in order to fill the food hampers, and the pantry was getting low. And I talked to the person that kind of coordinates the volunteers, and she said, yeah, we're okay for this week, but it's going to get pretty tight for next week. And I prayed, God, we're here. We will serve you however. You know, we're trying to provide for your children, but we can't create the food. And then I went into our staff meeting. When I came out of our staff meeting, I had a voicemail, a call that came in about 10 minutes after I prayed. And, you know, I'm listening to it, and the voice on the phone says, hi, my name's Jesse. You don't know me. I didn't know about you guys until about a week ago when somebody told me about you. But I've got 2 pallets of food, and I'm wondering if you guys can use it. And I thought, oh, this was like an hour ago. And I phoned him back, and I said, "Hi, my name's Tim. You left me a voicemail." "Yes, yes, the answer is yes, we can." And he said, "Oh, good, because I took a chance. I'm about 3 minutes away." And God pulled this together. Like, there is no way that I know enough people to orchestrate something like this. We had another instance, and this one is really God tear it down or build it up. We had a phone call from the Calgary Stampede come in, as I was mentioning earlier. 10 pallets of food. We could take 3, and that was a deal breaker. They called us the next morning, and they said, "We've decided we can split it up, and you can have 3 pallets." And the first thought through my head was, yay! Second thought was, I really needed to know this last night because I don't have a trailer or a truck. So we started making phone calls, and I hit a company. Within a half hour, I'd found a company that had a trailer we could use. Not a truck, though. So we called camp, and the maintenance guy said, "Yeah, just finished up a job. I can jump in the truck and head your way." So he headed in to town. We went over to hook up the trailer. I thought, this is coming together. God is providing. We get all set. We back the truck into place. And the shop lead with the company across the street comes out and he goes, "Your rear bumper's bent. We can't get at the electrical connection." It's like, oh, man, this is a heavy-duty bumper. And they backed into a tree stump or something. So he gets down there, and it's like, okay, it's kind of at a stop. My boss is standing there, and she goes, "Tim, it's looking like it wasn't meant to be." No. God didn't provide a truck and a trailer for nothing. Like, Lord, build it up or tear it down. If it isn't meant to be, if you're not in this, just end it here. If it's meant to be, I know you're going to solve it. And the shop lead is down on the ground, and he's looking at it. It's like, heavy-duty bumper. Hand me a crowbar. And it's like, what is a 170-pound guy with a crowbar going to do against a heavy-duty bumper? And he's working on it and goes, "Oh, there, I think we've got access now." Yay. Yay, God. We get all set to plug in the electrical. There's no lights. My boss looks at me again like, "Tim, you're struggling through step by step." It's like, no, I'm not struggling through step by step. This is either of God or it isn't, and I'm okay either way. Lord, if this is of you, build it up. If it's not of you, stop it. And I hear the guy at the back of the trailer going, "Hang on, the lights came on." Are you kidding me? My boss is standing there. Oh, like again and again. We get down to the Stampede grounds with the longest trailer I've ever pulled in rush hour traffic. That was bizarre. Down to pick up our pallets of food, and we get them loaded. And we get back up to Hope Mission with about 15 minutes to spare before the forklift driver from across the street was punching off the clock. If we hadn't made it back by then, the food would have sat outside over the weekend and been destroyed. So here we are, 10 minutes before the deadline, and God put 3 pallets of food in our cooler to help with the hampers and help the families. Sometimes God builds it up. Sometimes he tears it down. But he is always faithful. Challenges kept coming up throughout the day, but we kept refocusing. This is not about us, God. This is about your children. And whether or not this is your plan for provision, please build it up or tear it down. And he built it up. How do you praise God when things like that happen in your life? What does that kind of reverence look like? Jesus told us in the timeless words that Matthew recorded, "Love the Lord your God with all your soul, with all your heart, with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself." He told us our job. You might ask, what if I'm holding back There's times I wonder, am I holding back? Like, is that my struggle? Because God doesn't throw all kinds of obstacles at us. We throw obstacles at us. Take it to God in prayer. He understands. People have been hurt and betrayed throughout history. Everyone has a story about being let down by someone else at some point or another. Everyone. Often they don't have to go back more than a few days or maybe a few weeks. You've been hurt. I've been hurt. Being hurt sucks. Being completely vulnerable is a really big ask. But when it's to God, how can you be completely assured that God's presence or of God's presence and ability to work in and through you? Because God has demonstrated his power. He has made a promise to his people that will last forever. And God will remember it forever. I have a challenge for each and every one of us for this week. Pause. Just for a moment. Several times throughout the week if you can. Praise God for his faithfulness. Nothing else. Just pause. Praise God for your faithfulness. Praise for your faithfulness, Lord. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All who follow his precepts have good understanding. To him belongs eternal praise. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your faithfulness. We praise you. Lord, help us as we face things to remember that regardless of the circumstances, regardless of where it's going to go, you are eternally faithful. You ordained your covenant with us. You remember your covenant with us, and you're looking for us to respond. And our response is to give you all the praise. Father, I thank you for today, and as we head out from here, I pray that we would remember your faithfulness and strive really hard to share you with others and to be faithful in return. In the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
I invite you to stand as we sing number 210. My Jesus, I love thee. I know. Sin, I resign. My gracious Redeemer, my Savior, art thou. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. I love thee because thou hast first loved me and purchased my pardon on Calvary's tree. I love thee for wearing the thorn on thy brow. If ever
is now.
Thank you for being here this morning. It is good to be in the house of the Lord. Just a reminder, after the benediction, Paul is looking for members to hang around. There's a vote going on, so that would be wonderful if you could hang around here and he doesn't have to track you down in the parking lot and stuff. But please, let's bow our heads for the benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Go, for you are the Lord's people, and he is your God, and he is forever faithful. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.